everybody. I am Sakshi and welcome to today's Speakin webinar. It is my delight to have Mr. Indraneel on board with me today. Mr. Indraneel is the president and the head of HR at UTI Mutual Fund. He has formerly also worked with HDFC Life and Shoppers Stop, managing large-scale transformation and change management projects. With over two decades of experience, Mr. Indraneel is an accomplished and experienced HR professional, having worked across implementation, execution, and strategic roles. Along with experience across employee engagement, HR operations, corporate governance, his working energy and attention to detail and solution-oriented outlook are guiding lights for his employees. His strong belief is that nurturing the younger generation would build the future leaders. His success mantra has been to be in constant dissatisfaction with the status quo and to bring in change in everything and everywhere. I'm delighted to welcome you, Mr. Indraneel.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us today. It's a pleasure to be talking to a leader of your stature. I will get to the questions now that everybody's been waiting for. So talking about, how the HR role has evolved, of course, over this long span of 22 decades of, experience that you've had. I read somewhere that HR professionals are now also marketers, designers, and supply and demand experts. HR roles and responsibilities are now shifting from being a support system to being a more strategic, being more inclined with the business objectives. Could we just know your opinion about this over your enriching span of career?
Thank you very much. As you rightly said, there's a lot has changed. If I go back to somewhere in year 2000, we had no clue what this digital world is all about. Social media was nowhere seen across that time. Socializing was all about meeting people or going out with people. There was no social media as such. Automation was very limited, and most of the work was done manually. So if I remember, we used to do attendance management, leave management, payroll, everything which was highly manual. And there were a lot of work it was involved in that. I think we have moved away from that situation as has come a long way. Today, anything and everything which is mundane, operational, is being automated. You don't need to involve human being to do these jobs. And I think business has evolved. People have evolved. Customers have evolved. Everything has changed. The world has changed completely. Hence, the expectation from every role has changed. So in the current context, if you see that the demand is so different, that the role of HR has changed. HR is no more into engagement and retention of manpower on a day-to-day basis. They have to think beyond that. They have to think that how do we take this organization to the next level? And for that, are our employees ready to move to the next level? Do we have the right set of talent to take this organization to the next level? Or are we grooming the right set of talent to take up a larger role in the organization? So these are very pertinent, I would not say challenges, but issues or pertaining areas where HR has to focus on. Rather living on today, we have to think of tomorrow. And that is how we'll be able to survive as an organization in the current context.
Absolutely, Mr. Indraneel. So talking about change, like just continuing that topic, and you being a torchbearer of change management yourself, these times that we're going through are only, an affirmation and attestation that change will always be the only constant. I have repeatedly read everywhere that HR are the drivers of change. They are the change managers in an organization. Could you shed some light on this entire area of change management by the HR And as you already mentioned from your last question, what are certain trends which are currently going on, especially during this pandemic, in these, in the change management area?
I think all of us have heard that change is constant, and now change has become instant. So in the current pandemic, we realized that suddenly overnight we had to change everything. We had to change the way we work, the change we operate on a regular basis. I think HR is a facilitator to the change, and this change will vary from organization to organization, from business to business. In the current pandemic, if I had to change certain things, or a financial services organization has to make certain changes, probably a aviation or for a hotel industry had to make some other changes. So it is the degree would change, and it depends on the organization, its business, and the history of the organization also plays a very big role. How old is the organization? Is what's the kind of people that you have in the organization, etc. makes a lot of difference. But at the end of the day, we do these changes because we want to live for the future. We want to live in the future. We want to be there in the future, in this industry or in this market. And that change is gradual, and it is very, very important that we keep in mind that whether our people and the business has the appetite to take certain changes and do take steps which are gradual and which is very impactful going forward. So you spoke about what are those couple of areas or changes that we can see which is coming in. And I would say, irrespective of this pandemic, I think in my last point also I spoke about is that this entire change of communication has taken a very, very big place in the current context. And when it comes to communication, it has to be transparent, and it has to be to the point, and it has to be it has to give that line of sight to the individual, that why am I here and how am I contributing to the organization. So that is one aspect. Second aspect is, because we are all remotely working, it is important that we understand that everybody is involved in the current context. Everybody is working together in the current context. If I do not feel involved in this current context, then I would feel left out. There will be a lot of anxiety. There are a lot of other concerns that will creep up. And I think the most important thing which is happening currently is that any organization will look forward to see that how do I ensure that my employees are learning new things. Can be self-learning, it can be learning through various programs, it can be off-the-shelf programs, but the learning journey has to happen. We have to ensure that the learning roadmap is clear for people and they understand that they have to learn new things. And the last and the most important thing is that we have to be very, very sharp and very specific about what do we want to do. And we have to use technology as much as possible. And I think by doing this, we are doing good to ourselves only, because we are getting ready for the future. Anyway, we have to do this after a couple of months or years. We are advancing it.
Very true. Just wanting to talk about this for a little longer. As we talked about the kind of changes that are there across industries which are happening, since you have a bird's eye view of being a president and an HR head, could you shed some light upon the challenges that the finance or the asset management industry particularly, like yourself, are facing right now at this moment? And do you think they are, different, similar from the other industries?
So obviously, in our kind of industry, it is a little different than what a airline or a hotel industry is going through, and also different than what a manufacturing unit will go through. be for us working remotely will not be a challenge, because we don't need a manufacturing unit or we don't need infrastructure to operate. Technology will be good enough for us. I think the challenge that we are looking at is as I said, that there is a lot of younger talent that is coming to the coming to corporate world at this point of time, especially those management trainees and all those people who are joining. And there is there's a lot of concern and fear among them. What I'm seeing is because this is the probably first year in the history that I have seen that people are joining organization virtually without going to office. And I can understand an experienced person is joining virtually, but a new person who has never worked in any company is joining virtually is little different. It's a little different. You have to have that focus, that patience, and that learning roadmap for those set of people so that they come on board smoothly. I think that's one challenge that everyone would face. And second is, in general, in any industry at this point of time, talent movement will get restricted because people are very, very careful moving from one organization to other organization. And at the same time, you have to ensure that your people are engaged. Your people are not worried about things that keep on hearing from outside. That's why it's better we continuously do our conversation with our people so that they remain engaged with the organization and they don't get disengaged at this point of time.
Absolutely. Talking about new talent, as you said, and the kind of challenges that you would be facing to probably onboard them. Just talking about this entire recruitment part of it, a lot has been discussed about a person being the right fit for a company and dwelling and gelling into the company's culture or the company's personality, as they say. So about these terminologies, you know, perfect fit, company culture, could you just shed some light upon this and how exactly is it measured or assessed?
I think it has evolved in the last couple of years. There was a time when we used to focus a lot on measuring cultural fit of an individual. I think now more than organization, individuals are also looking at their own fitment into the organization, whether they want to choose this organization or not. Not because of the role, it's also because of whether they'll be comfortable working with this organization or not. And in the current situation, there is so much of information available outside, in social media, in all across, that you don't need to do an assessment for this. An individual can get to know about the organization from various places and various people. At the same time, organizations, earlier we used to do a lot of assessment to understand the cultural fitment, but I see that it has changed, it has evolved, and there are companies who are doing social profiling of people just to understand they will fit into the organization or not. Now, coming to the point of what is this fitment, it is not about only that whether you are fitting into the role or not, whether you will be comfortable working with us or not, whether you'll be comfortable working in a group or not. I think fitting to the role is important, but fitting into the organization in terms of whether you gel well with the people in the organization is also equally important. And it's long-term, and it is done because it has to be sustainable. I might join an organization because the role is great, but after joining the organization, I might realize that my culture or my way of doing things is very different. And nowadays, there are a lot of organizations, they do their personality measurement. I mean, that means every organization has their own personality. They try and see that whether the individual is fitting into this personality or not. So that's very, very important. Now it has become very important for both individual and for the organization. And please understand, when organization talks about cultural fit, they want a long-term association. They do not want to hire somebody who is a talented individual and then fail in the organization because he's not been able to collaborate or gel well in the organization.
Absolutely. It also answers one of my leading questions, where I wanted to ask you, how is a fit weighed against a person's competencies? Like when you're hiring somebody, what if somebody is individually very competent, but probably is of a very different mindset than the company is? How are decisions taken?
Hello?
Yeah, hello?
Yeah. So but I think it depends on role to role. There are certain roles which are very, very individual specific, or the roles which is individual contributor role and very technical role. In those roles, gelling with the organization may not be the priority, but there are roles which are very critical roles where you have to work with, a larger group, you have to lead a team. There we have to ensure, the individual also should ensure that he joins an organization and being part of the team, which he would enjoy to be part of the team.
Absolutely. Another question that I had about is also about a point that you had made earlier, that the communication in companies, in the higher level management, is becoming more and more transparent now. So, about companies having an open and authentic communication channel, especially because in these times we are not having an in-person connect, we are having a virtual connect. So what are your thoughts about, and what are some trends that you can probably give us about the open and authentic communication that the companies have started having?
So I think you answered it. I think the conversation matters. How you do the conversation and where you do the conversation is irrelevant at this point of time. In last couple of months, I have realized one thing. We used to travel extensively just to meet people, or used to make people travel across to meet us or meet others. I don't know how much time you used to spend talking to the individual and how much energy or enthu left in us after doing so much of journey to talk to people in depth. I think in the current situation, if you have the willingness and if you have the transparency, and you can do a genuine conversation. And you can do an impactful, genuine conversation. I mean, if I'm talking to you on this webinar, I'm not feeling that we are not in same office or we are not face to face. We're just talking. I mean, in the month of Feb also, I didn't know that we can recruit people without meeting them. But after 15 days, 20 days, when we realized that things are not going to change for the time being, we said we have to do these conversations. We have to virtually meet people. And we have been successful. And every organization must be doing this.
Great. Actually, just working on this point of you talking about virtually interacting with people and being successful in it. There has been something that we've always wondered about. There's one thing called remote working and one lesser talked about thing called remote management. Now that each of your functions, which was majorly probably aligned towards the interactions, engagement that you have with the employees, across hiring, retention, engagement, all the activities have become completely virtual. And since you talk about your success, if you could give some guide points, some guideposts to organizations on how is it that you have been successful or hit the bullseye with respect to probably the initiatives or change in processes or certain new strategies that you brought about?
I think I would not say that whatever we have been doing is everything is right, but I can talk about some of the experiences that I have.
Sure.
I think remote management has been was the concern. Remote working was not the concern. Every leader always felt that if my team is away from me, I don't know how to manage the team. I mean, because I cannot control them. And that had to change. And that had to change because we realized that if everybody has to work in this current situation, then how do we make it more effective? How do we make it more relevant for them? And for that, I realized one is that without telling people, people use technology very effectively. And I also saw that a lot of people proactively curtailed a lot of processes which was probably not relevant at this point of time. So that you reduce those operational work. And people become very sharp in their expectations with their teams. And the job work become very defined jobs with timelines. And conversations increased. When the conversation increase, you realize that you are understanding your people better and better and helping them out to do their job far better than how they were doing. Probably earlier you didn't have those opportunities to speak to people or deal with people with so much of detail because there were a lot of other things. So when I'm in office, there are a lot of people who walk into my room to talk to me. And then sometimes it becomes a very lengthy conversation and some of the conversation is very important. But some of the common conversations are not necessarily very important. I think we have been able to curtail those. We have not been traveling. We are not going to events outside. So we have also realizing that how we become more sharp and to the point and be very, very specific about what deliverables we want. I think another very important thing, point I noticed in a lot of organizations and leaders is that there are small initiatives that people used to take for incremental benefits. I think those are going away. Now we are taking initiatives which are more strategic and long-term and will solve larger problems. Because that is something which we want to focus now. And that is going to make the difference because small initiatives will take away a lot of time and energy from people. Do one big initiative, focus on it, ensure it is being delivered, you will see results out of it.
Definitely. One more thing that now that we're talking about initiatives and you also mentioned, skill development or probably getting to know things better, getting to know the new technology and a lot of other things that have come our way. So since a lot of ways of working, business models, a lot of things, operations, a lot of things have been changing during these times and everybody has to evolve to be a part of this new order of the world. How do you see, upskilling, de-skilling, reskilling, things like these as becoming a part of your HR management? Also, because one question that I had leading to it is that how is it that the HR manages to convince or motivate the workforce give time into, skill development when already a lot of their time space is being taken by the business activities that they actually do.
Okay, I'll answer the second piece first. lot of time taken for business, and I think most of the learning happens when you are doing your business. On the job training is the best training, and that gives you the best of the experiences. The only thing you should be able to learn from there and execute it and ensure that you do not repeat any mistake that you have done in past. So that's I think if business is taking a lot of time, then that means you are involved and you are learning a lot of things. So to me, it's a good sign. The first part which you were talking about, and I think pre-pandemic also, and now it has become very evident, is that we have to evolve as an organization, and we have to see that how self-learning take place in an organization. And the organization has to create a culture of self-learning, and it has to be long-term, and people should see that there is benefit of self-learning. And I'll give you one of the thought I have, and probably we're doing this, started doing this now, is that if you ask someone that you go and learn these five things, you do not know how they're learning and how they are gaining or exposure or skill or knowledge around this. You run series of quiz programs. And in those quiz programs, you ask people to participate, and now you have a mobile app, everything. I mean, you can sit at home, wherever you are, you can participate for these quizzes and create some contest around it. The kind of scores, number of credits, etc., will lead to higher education for you. You accumulate 500 points, I'll sponsor you something. You accumulate 1,000 points, I'll sponsor you something. And create excitement. If you do the same thing every day, it will become mundane. You have to create excitement every time you do run this quiz program. I mean, this time you say that you get 100 credit points, next time you say in this quiz, you will get 200 credit points. And cover everything that is important for today and the future. I don't know how it will look like, but I think it will lead to a lot of self-learning. It will lead to engagement. It will lead to excitement. It will lead to collaboration. People will form teams. They will start learning. They will start participating. You as an organization will also understand what is the knowledge base of your people. You can plan your training programs for your employees based on their scores or their performance in these quiz programs. And it's fun. That one thought I had and I have implemented. And I'm sure that there are many more thoughts like this can be inculcated in an organization, where you will ensure that you do upskilling, reskilling, deskilling, whatever you want to do, without getting into too many training programs, etc. With these things, you know that I have information and I know exactly where I have to invest for training for people. And at the same time, you are ensuring they're learning on their own and own and own. If you go and ask somebody that you go to internet and learn all these things, they might not learn. But if you say that next Friday I have a quiz on XYZ, I'm sure they will do the level best. Nobody wants to. There's a leaderboard that we create. I don't think anybody will would like to see his name with lower scores.
Absolutely. That's a great way to motivate everybody. So moving on, now that we also know that your ideologies lie in nurturing the younger generation. So obviously the buck never stops at hiring the people. It's also about developing and nurturing the talent while they are in the company. So what are some aspects that you follow to keep this ideology at the forefront of your HR operations? How is it that you, nurture talent? What is your, or probably we'll just go with, I have a leading question to it. How do you go about nurturing the talent? I know there's a skill development of the people who've already been there in the company. But as you talked about, there are a lot of people who have joined virtually right now. It's a new start of the career for them as well. So how is it that you go about nurturing this talent?
I think first and foremost, I see this, all the new talents who comes from specifically from management institute, they all want to do strategic role. From the day one, everybody wants to do strategic role and they talk about it. It is important you set the expectation right. Unless until you work at the ground level, you cannot get into a strategic role, and it will not happen overnight. It will happen over a period of time. It takes time for you to reach there. That line of sight has to be there. If you have not been able to give that line of sight to people in first 15 days of the person joining the organization, you are not giving direction to the person. I mean, organization will have their own expectation, individual will have their own expectation, and it will not marry each other, and there will be disaster. So it is very, very important that the first 15 days when you do your induction and other pieces, engagement activities, you make sure you set the expectation right and tell them exactly how your learning will happen in this organization. That is one aspect, very, very important. Second is, they're new in the organization. They need a friend in the organization who may not be their mentor, but who can guide them on small, small things and make them comfortable in the organization. Assign a buddy to this guy. And assign a buddy who is willing to become a buddy. Don't assign a buddy who is not willing to become a buddy. That's a disaster. And the third and the most important is that create at least a 6 months learning roadmap with a mentor. You have to also invest in the mentor. Don't just pick up somebody and say that you are his mentor. Then it is all up to the mentor how he wants to teach the person. It is that you have to identify a set of people who can do the mentoring job and who is willing to do the mentoring job. Do their own orientation around mentoring and how they will handle this set of people. And then make a 6 month plan which can be broken into weeks, days, months, put review mechanism around that, put learning plans around that, put various assessments around that, involve both the groups as much as possible, take feedback, give feedback, do peer evaluation, create a more holistic approach for the learning of these set of people. I think after a year, those who think that, yes, I want to be part of this organization, they will stay. Others will take their own call. And that's the best thing to do. Let's not give wrong hope to anybody that in 2 years' time, I will make you a leader or a manager. Whereas I know that it takes at least 2 to 3 years' time for you to understand certain aspects of the business. But yes, I will take care of you is something you have to give that environment which is very conducive for their learning.
Absolutely. That's a very insightful point about mentoring the mentor, which a lot of organizations or individuals would not touch upon. So that's a very, very insightful point. So having talked about the nurturing from the company's perspective, you yourself being, having your ideologies in nurturing the new talent. If you could just give a few guide points to the individuals who are probably starting their career and are in the early stages, some guide points to those individuals about succeeding in their careers and carving their career path or their career development in the right direction.
I think one piece is very, very important that we should do our homework well. I mean, if I go or do anything on a daily basis, I try and see that I do some homework around it. I think today's new generation, they need to do their homework well. They need to do their research well, and they have so much of information available around them, which was not there earlier. So please make use of that information. I think that's the first point I have. Second is, don't get hassled and don't panic. I mean, this situation is there, it will go away. I mean, so it is not going to stay with us forever. So don't hassle and don't panic and don't think that I have to do something different to get my career going. Yes, you have to be very, very, you have to do a lot of introspection that whatever you are doing today is making sense or not. Do we need to do something new? And see that if new things can be done. One of the reasons why organizations want to hire new set of people is that they want to bring in change. They want to bring in newer way of working. If you do not think and bring newer way of working, why will you be hired? So that is very important point people should keep in mind. And third is, we should speak to people, or we should converse with people who are outside our domain. That will broaden our horizon. If I'm HR, I'll only talk to HR guy, or if I'm financial services, I'll only talk to people in financial services, will give me very little scope to do new things. I can talk to an entrepreneur, I can talk to somebody who is into telecom, I can talk to somebody who is probably into beauty business. I might get some ideas, I might get some thoughts, I might get some something which is not being done in our kind of industry. And that's how I will remain relevant myself. Otherwise, I'll become redundant and I'll become one of the other people like any normal employee. Then I should not expect that I should be treated differently. I should become leader fast and all those things. So I think patience is key. Do your homework, learn new things, talk to people who are outside your domain, and then the very important is that be transparent and candid. And if you know somebody who is a great friend of yours or whom you are comfortable, talk to that person and share your anxiety, your concerns, your issues. I'm sure that you'll feel better.
Absolutely. Those were very, very insightful for me as well. Talking about being relevant, and having talked about the so generally the segment that I want to go in now is the future of HR, right? And we have already talked about the human aspect of it with some great insights by your side. Talking about the the other aspect of the future of HR, talking about the digital transformation, as you had already touched upon earlier as well, I wanted to ask about, since there's this heavy discussion going on about digitization of processes and other things, how is it that, how much of it is reality, first of all? And secondly, how much, what is the outlook of the HR circles to maintain the optimal balance? Because at the end of the day, it's a human resource function. So there's got to be a human touch as well.
I think there are a lot of processes where you don't need a human touch, which can be automated. In fact, with human touch, you create challenges or problem for people. It becomes difficult for people to go through those manual processes. These automations has evolved. Again, I will say it depends on the kind of organization you are, what kind of business you are doing, what kind of people you have, and how you are spread your manpower across. So that's how the automations have happened all across. when it comes to human touch in terms of learning engagement, retention, or looking at building talent for future, I think human touch is not necessarily be you sit face to face, which I had spoken earlier also. It is that the conversation that you do, whether it is relevant or not, or the kind of career path you provide to people, whether it is relevant for the individual or not. It doesn't matter if you sit in office in front of an individual hours and hours and do not give him the right set of career guidance, or do not give the person any kind of learning quotient, then it doesn't make sense. So yes, human touch is about caring people, caring for their career, caring for their learning. I think.
Absolutely. So moving on to the last segment, which I would really like to understand from you. We have covered some very important points around the information of an HR function and functionalities. I would really now request you to give us some bits about your own leadership journey, since it's over a span of 2 decades and it has been across industries and functions. How has your journey been throughout this time, and what have been your learnings?
I think most of the leaders have gone through this journey, and there are certain things, if you learn fast, it is easier for you to groom talent in your team, and also you grow as a talent. I remember when I had become the first time manager, my thought was the formula that I use is the best formula, and I wanted all my team members to use the same formula. And I used to feel very uncomfortable that if the individual is not doing the way I wanted him to do. And it was very frustrating. Probably I had not realized that time that every individual has its own individuality. You have to understand the strength and weakness and of the person, and then accordingly assign responsibility and ensure that you leverage on the strength of the person and develop the weakness to strength for the individual. It took a lot of time for me to also understand, and I'm sure for a lot of leaders it takes time. It's very difficult to let go things. When you know that this can be done in this way, it's very difficult to let go. But if you get involved in that, then whatever you are supposed to do at your level, you will not be able to do that. You will not be able to see what your boss is doing, and see that how can I support my boss doing his job. That was the objective. Rather looking at what my subordinate is doing throughout the day, and seeing that how he can do well and I will make him do well, is something which does not work. You have to empower people. You have to give guidance. You might tell a lot of stories to people that how you had done in past, but ultimately the guy will do the way that he wants to do. You have to guide the person. You have to help the person to learn in the process. There might be mistakes, but let the mistakes happen. I realized my bosses has allowed me to do mistakes, and that's how I have grown. If I don't allow people to do mistakes, they will not learn. And if I try to spoon feed everything to people, then they're doing only execution. I think this is something which every leader has been doing, will do, and keep on doing. And then only they will create great leaders, and they'll also become good leaders. I think that's very, very important. Second piece, I think I have always looked at is that how do you ensure diversity of thought, which is very, very important. I have realized over a period of time is that do people think differently, and how do you bring in those different thoughts together and create something out of it is something very, very important. And for that, you need to have a lot of collaboration. And then that's, so we currently talk about diversity. The moment we talk about diversity, we talk about male-female ratio. We talk about whether you are differently abled people, et cetera, et cetera. But it's all about, it starts, the starting point is diversity of thought. And to do that, you need to have a blend of people externally coming to the organization, people internally in the organization, people coming from junior level, people coming from senior level. So it has to be a mix. When I spoke about involvement in the beginning when we were talking, is the involvement of people across the spectrum so that you get best out of it. And I think there is no better learning than that, according to me. And third and very important, which I learned hard ways, is that listen to people. Try and understand what the individual is trying to say or the point that the individual is making. You may not be able to do everything that individual is asking or talking or doing, wanting to do, but at least you can listen to the person and see that what all we can do out of it. And for any organization, bottom-up communication is very, very important. Communication cannot be only top-down. It has to be bottom-up also. I think these are some of the thoughts that I have seen or learned over a period of time.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. That was very, very enriching. A few questions from our participants. Devesh Khaitan actually has two questions. One is that, why is it that people leave, employees leave for financial reasons? And how should an HR look into a matter like this?
Okay, so financial reason can be a need of an individual. And these needs varies from person to person, and the context also is known to the individuals. But any study that you have seen, it says that people leave organization and their bosses, not for money. And any study that we do, that what is the most important thing for you in your career, it's always the role and the environment. It's not the money. So if any individual is leaving for money, there might be some specific reason of the individual. As an organization, we need to ensure that we are rewarding the right talent for the right contribution, which is very, very important.
True. I hope that answers your question, Devesh. Another question by him only. Is what kind of tools and exercises an HR should use to reduce the sort of politics or manipulation or toxicity which is there in the organization?
Communication. If your seniors and your management is connected with people, then I don't see there is any room for politics or there is any room for rumor within the organization. You should, anytime you see any rumor, you should kill it then and there with the right information.
Absolutely. So those were the questions. That's it. The questions from my side also. It was really great having you on board with us, learning from your leadership journey yourself, the kind of experiences that you've had across the organizations, answering all of our questions. It was a really, really insightful and enriching discussion. And thank you so much for being with us here today.
Thank you very much, Sakshi, for this session. And I have also enjoyed a lot talking.